Welcome, everyone. I'm Felicia Day, and this is Stranger Things Unlocked, where Netflix Geeked gives you an exclusive look into the shows you love. And be warned, there will be spoilers. Today, we flash up horror movies with the Duffer Brothers.
A lot of times there are these supernatural monsters, but really a lot of the horror comes from the humans in the story.
Break down Joyce and Hopper's epic escape from Siberia.
I found my inner wolf, my inner Russian bear.
Talk with Millie Bobby Brown on set.
Her most valued thing that she has in her life is her superpowers, and taking that away, where does that leave us?
Dive deeper into Lover's Lake with swim team captain Steve Harrington.
Getting to do that sort of stuff is like true movie magic.
Talk with Shawn Levy about directing that epic shootout.
We took the time and we took the passion to make it right.
We roll the dice and unpack the D&D and basketball mashup to end all mashups, which is so amazing. And go behind the scenes on Max's Kate Bush-powered mind lair escape. What do you say we crank things up to 11? Nitty-gritty on season 4 directly from the masterminds themselves. Please welcome the Duffer Brothers, Matt and Ross. Thank you so much for being here.
Oh, thanks for having us.
Can you talk a little bit about the adult themes and horror that have come in as your cast have grown up? Is that a factor in kind of like graduating the horror with the children's age?
Yeah,
it really is. I mean, obviously when we started the show, they were so little, and so one of the big changes this year, besides our characters being in different locations, is that the quote-unquote kids are now not kids anymore, and they're in high school. And so suddenly it opened up a lot of doors for us. We can't do the Goonies fun adventure anymore, but what we can do is we can go, okay, well, now they can be in a horror movie. We can put them in danger that is really scary, and we can look at, you know, some of the movies that we loved growing up, like Nightmare on Elm Street or Hellraiser, the stuff that we were getting into when we were around that age in high school. Mm-hmm. We were just trying to scare ourselves constantly.
Yeah.
And so we could infuse some of that in their storyline. And I think for the first time for them, it's like, it's really, we wanted it to be really scary. The stuff going on with Max and all of this, it's like, let's just push this and try to be as scary as possible and put them in the middle of just a true horror film.
Yeah, and I binged all of it together, and it is a beautiful progression, season to season, how it gets more uncomfortable and more uncomfortable, and finally in this one, I'm like, what? Exactly. Did you intend on that?
Yeah, some of it is, it's them growing older forces the show to evolve, forces us to change the writing, and so every season is completely different. And, you know, as Ross was saying, they're going into high school, and that lends itself or reminds us of a certain type of movie. Also, middle school for us was like a fun, amazing, joyful experience. Like I have some of the best memories of my life, most of them were in middle school, occurred in middle school. High school was horrible,
So
for us at least. So I have nothing but terrible memories from high school, most stressful time in my life. For us, if you're not into, you know, we weren't athletically gifted, whatever, we were into movies, we grew up in a town that only cared about basketball, so it was not fun. So it was, anyway, so it just felt like, okay, this is where you can explore depression and anxiety, and you know, all of that can be represented by this monster, Vecna. So it just felt, it felt right.
Richard, did you hear me? Open the closet!
It felt right to go darker. Also, I think we had just come off writing season 3, and which was our fun pop blockbuster summer season. We wanted it to feel like a big blockbuster movie. We wanted it a little bit silly. We wanted
these neon colors.
Yeah, we wanted sharp tonal clashes. We talked about Temple of Doom all the time, how, you know, it would go from, you know, you'd have gore juxtaposed with, you know, silly comedy and romance. That's what we were trying to do with season 3. And then season 4, it was, let's go Nightmare on Elm Street, let's go Hellraiser. And a lot of that started with up with Vecna high school. But you're talking about how horrible high school was.
And you see there's a shift at the end of 3 where it does get sad and it does get darker. And so we sort of went with that and ran with it. And you've got to, we try to season to season go, well, let's not ignore the events that happened previously.
So, yeah, you feel that impact, really, especially in Max's arc. Max. Really resonating.
That's what we want to do and just go. And we did try to do it season two as well, which is something traumatic happened to these characters. So let's go with that and let's see how they actually respond to it. And how would someone respond to something this traumatic in real life? They wouldn't be able to just shake it off and go about their normal lives.
Yeah, and that's beautiful. You could do that in this format versus like regular episodic TV.
Exactly.
Now you say you kind of dovetailed that emotional thing from 3 to 4. We're in 4 and now going to 5. And
right.
I believe that you said that you've had the complete story arc was planned out from the beginning. Is that true?
I mean, roughly. I mean, the show evolves, right? So you discover things. Like, I mean, it's not, I mean, there's a rough map, but it's just constantly changing. I mean, the perfect example of that is Steve.
Tommy,
like,
Tommy.
Steve, you know, played by beautifully by Joe Keery.
He wasn't
supposed to be
here.
He shouldn't be in season 4. He shouldn't be a lead in season 4. So that he shouldn't be a good guy, right? Mm-hmm. So a lot of that you're discovering as you're going. So you're learning what works, what doesn't work. And that's what I do love about television, is that you're finding it. The cast is impacting where you're taking the narrative. The other writers who we work with are impacting it. So the other directors who are working on the show, it's this living thing.
Yeah.
So it's changed.
Yeah, it's beautiful. When you see Steve in the season 1, you're like, ah, that guy's going to get killed off. And so wonderfully surprising. It was the plan to kill Steve.
Well, I don't know. Was he supposed to die?
No. No. No.
Yeah,
I don't remember.
He was supposed to die in the finale.
I thought it was, because I thought originally it was, you know, because there's that scene where really, which is the beginning of his turn, which is when he comes back in the end and he comes and ends up fighting the Demogorgon with Jonathan and Nancy. And originally that was going to be Jonathan's dad, Lonnie. So it just, which is, I it's hard to even imagine what that would have looked like. I don't remember that Steve was going to die.
I'm pretty sure he was going to die earlier.
It's
been a while.
It's fascinating.
But anyway, that's what I'm saying is,
it does evolve.
It evolves. So it's not like we're making it all up as we go along, but the characters and the actors and everyone who works on the show informs what we're doing.
Yeah, and so did you have the Vecna Henry one twist in mind from the beginning? How did you set that up for so many seasons, and yet we didn't catch on because it was really a surprise.
Oh, that's great. When we originally pitched the show to Netflix, we really just had that first season planned out. Mm-hmm. But I remember part of the way through writing season 1, Netflix said, "Hey, can you guys just walk us through the mythology of the show?" And so we sat down with our writers and we spent a couple weeks just going, okay, what is the upside down and how did it come to be and what monsters are in there and all of this. And that document, it's about a 20-page document, and that really has most of what we're talking about now. It doesn't have, of course, it wasn't like there's gonna be a twist in season 4. It wasn't that detailed, but the big beats there, and there's still stuff. And we hint about it in this season. We start getting into a little bit about the upside down, but we don't answer it yet. But we have those answers.
Mm-hmm.
So the last sort of remaining questions that are answered in that document, we've punted a couple of those to have some big reveals in season 5. And that's really gonna affect what season 5 is about.
Stranger Things has a lot of pretty scary monsters, but we all know that the worst monsters, for me, especially when I'm watching it, the worst monsters are the bullies and the jocks. Did you intend on that?
Well, I think, you know, when we developed this show and came up with it, we were really inspired by Stephen King and in his work, which is something we haven't been shy about. And I think, you know, what's really something that really is important to his work is that, yes, a lot of times there are these supernatural monsters, but really a lot of the horror comes from the humans in the story and the darkness within all of us. And so every season we really do want to have that to play a major role. And this season really is no different.
Mm-hmm. And like specifically like the jocks, I think we were interested in, you know, we've had some bad boy characters. We had Billy, you know, obviously in season 2 and 3, and then season 1, we kind of had these straight, you know, typical middle school bullies, but we wanted to explore someone who, had this never occurred, would have probably led a really good life. Like someone who was very popular, who had a sort of self-righteous streak in him, who was viewed by the community as completely virtuous. And then this thing happens, which is, you know, the death of his girlfriend. and it's just, it spins him. Mm-hmm. And all of this stuff that is inside of him that probably would have never been unlocked had that not occurred, comes spilling out. So that was, for us, an interesting character to explore.
And also the idea of, a lot of times we introduce a new character to this world and they see these extraordinary supernatural things and they react to it, I mean, sometimes in fear and wonder, but they're able mostly to sort of overcome that. And what we wanted to explore also was, well, what if a character sees this and he cracks a little bit?
Yeah.
Because it's hard, how would one react to seeing something so outside of what we think reality is? And yeah, so we wanted to explore that a little bit.
That's really interesting, because you don't normally see that. You always see these teenagers are like, yeah, I'm okay, let's save the world.
Yes,
and like, yeah, a lot of the characters do step up in nuanced ways. But yes, yeah, it's really interesting to explore that. We have a lot to look forward to, but thank you for gifting us volume one, because it is truly fantastic.
Thanks.
Thank you so much for being here today.
Of course. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Next, I sit down with Winona Ryder and David Harbour. Let's get back in the USSR, yeah. Adulting is hard, especially in Hawkins. To tell us more about that, please welcome David Harbour, who plays Hopper, Hawkins' police chief back from the dead, and Winona Ryder, who plays everyone's favorite Hawkins mom, Joyce Byers. David, you filmed some scenes in the USSR, definitely without love. There were a lot of brutal scenes in this season. How did we produce the film?
I mean, some of them were very pleasant on a soundstage in Atlanta, and some of them were in the snows of Lithuania. We shot in a real prison outside of, right in Vilnius, Lithuania, so the snow and the craziness. I mean, I guess the toughest stuff was, at one point, Hopper abandons his shoes as he escapes, and so for a lot of it, I'm running shoeless through the snows of Lithuania, and there were a lot of takes where you could see my feet, so we had to do that, and it's really not pleasant for your bare feet to be on snow for a long period of time. So I found my inner wolf, my inner Russian bear.
Okay, I'm gonna rewatch the episodes with that in mind. You're channeling that.
It's kind of a brutal season. I mean, it was brutal, like, physically in that way, and it was also kind of brutal emotionally. Like, Hopper goes to a darker place, I think, than we've ever seen him. Certainly in the prison, when we figure out exactly what happened to Sarah and to, you know, in his life before, that it was this kind of very dark, still moment of hopelessness for him. But then he is reinvigorated when, you know, two of his friends come to Russia to help him out.
Which is an epic journey. I don't know, do you know what could motivate Joyce to do something that impetuous?
I mean, it's Hopper. And when, like, you know, when I say he is like family, it like, literally, they are like family. And there's no way she couldn't have gone.
Joyce, where are you going?
The bank. I'm gonna get Enzo his damn money, and we are getting Hopper back.
Okay.
So I to me, it was just like, it made absolute sense.
Yeah. And for Hopper, I mean, you survived torture, you survive broken bones, the Soviet prison camp. Like, is the same thing keeping you going with Joyce?
I think that, you know, I mean, one of the great things about this relationship, one of the things I find very gratified and I think is really cool, is that it's so understated in the first season. I mean, I think that they talk briefly about knowing each other in high school. He's actually kind of like not the best to her in the beginning of the first season, kind of grows to be on her side. But clearly you can feel, and I think part of it was just, you know, Winona and what we chose to highlight in their relationship. But certainly, like, there was a beautiful scene that I remember in season two when they're talking about just like things getting easier and like smoking a cigarette at this kitchen table, that there's just so much depth to the relationship.
A lot of history in that scene.
And I think one of the beautiful things is that they've known each other when they were kids. Like, it's fun that the show's about kids, but you have these characters that knew each other when they were 13, 14, And then they split off, and he went and had an entire other life.
And then you have actors who are the kids during the time it set in.
Yeah, exactly.
Do you have a sense of nostalgia when you're in the makeup, the hair, the because I'm a kid of the 80s too. Like, yeah. I remember that as a tiny, tiny kid.
I mean, I have a natural sort of nostalgia because I mean, what year has Beetlejuice come out? 87?
87, I think.
Yeah. So I'm like literally, I probably would have gone to the movie theater. Wouldn't have gone. Hopper wouldn't have gone.
Well,
but maybe 11 would have like begged him to take her to the theater because she wanted to see the new Tim Burton movie.
Mm-hmm. I had a big obsession with Beetlejuice for sure when I was a kid.
I think maybe 11 will watch like Pee-wee's Playhouse in next season. Right? Because that was Tim's first movie.
Was it
Pee-wee's
Playhouse?
I like you, Dottie. Really? Like.
Oh my God.
You gotta pitch it.
Are the Duffers around? Because I want that impression in season 5.
I do want to talk a little bit about the Satanic Panic. Now we're talking about like flashbacks. Do you remember the Satanic Panic of the 80s?
I do.
Okay, tell me about that.
It was crazy. I mean, I really do remember this. I remember the censorship, Tipper Gore.
Yeah, Tipper,
Tipper Gore.
Do you remember Tom Hanks' first movie?
I mean, I remember being in love with Tom Hanks, The Man with One Red Shoe.
No, this is before this. I think it's an after-school special about Dungeons and Dragons.
What?
Oh, yeah,
oh wait a minute. It's the best. It's the best. It's like a TV movie. Tom Hanks is like on a D&D. He's like a Dungeons and Dragons dungeon master with his friends. It was about how if you played D&D, it was clearly a very Christian like organization. It was saying D&D's the devil and it's gonna possess you and make you insane. And Tom Hanks is wonderful in it.
Of course.
Michael Landon probably produced it.
Oh, Touched by an Angel. I remember that.
Yeah,
big hair, big heart. I'm not gonna let us go because David, I need to know both of you. What are you particularly geeking out over? What are you particularly excited about? I'm talking to you because we just talked about World of Warcraft. So I just need to get that a little bit on tape about World of Warcraft.
Oh my God, the most embarrassing thing in my existence.
What is World of Warcraft?
Okay. Right, so in 2005, I played the shit out of this game. It ruined my life. For
really?
Like a year. I mean, I was out of my mind. Yeah, I was wildly addicted to this video game.
What character did you play?
I remember, what?
What character did you play?
What was it? I was a Night Elf warrior.
Yeah, okay.
Called Norad. And he was like, you know, second tank of my whole guild. And
so you were a raider?
Oh yeah. I was like full on. And it's so funny because I also played The Sims. You ever played The Sims?
Oh yeah.
So The Sims,
I
like,
cheated
could,
all the time.
You could be an actor on The Sims. You can progress in your career, but what you have to do is you have to like work on things. You have to work on your speech and on your body, right?
Oh my God.
And I remember, but I remember my avatar got to like a certain
acting.
Level in his career, and I kept trying to get him to work on his speech and his.
He had to wait tables.
He was like a supporting player, but I wanted him to work on his speech and his body, and all he wanted to do was sit around and play video games. And and then I was like, whoa, whoa, whoa.
Okay.
I had this vortex moment where I saw my life, before my.
An actor playing that game could really mess with your head.
That's what it did.
Oh my God.
And that's why my life was ruined.
Well, you're doing pretty well for yourself.
I came back.
Yeah, you came back.
I'm the comeback kid.
You're pretty.
I'm the Tyson Fury of acting.
And your avatar's always waiting for you if you want to re-up.
Oh my God.
Winona, is there anything particularly that you're into? It doesn't need to be video games, cooking, like your pets. Like, is there anything you're pretty excited about?
Yeah. I mean, I'm just a huge movie fan of my dream when I was a kid. There was this theater in my town that was an old theater, and I wanted to my fantasy was when I grew up to rip out all the seats, put a bed, a tub, a bike to
exercise,
and just 24/7, watch movies, and never leave.
Yo, Netflix.
Yeah,
you need your next reality show. All you need to do is buy a theater and a bathtub and a bed and have Winona Ryder watch movies
24/7
for her whole life, and I will watch that show. I will watch the shit out of that show.
All right, you heard it here. Winona's win at movie theater, picked up on Netflix next season. Anyway, well, thank you so much for being here. It's been such a pleasure getting to know you. I admire your work so much. Both of you bring such gravity and humor and heart to the screen, and I cannot wait to see where your characters go from here. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you.
Can you guess who's next by reading my mind? I bet she could. That's right, we've got the lovely Millie Bobby Brown.
Levin starts off in Lenora, California. She starts off in school. She is very much dealing with the loss of Harbour, or as she thinks. And she's also dealing with the regular life of being at school, which is, she's bullied. And she's just trying to understand how to be a normal person, you know. She grew up in a laboratory, and she grew up very sheltered and told what to do.
Holy shit! What the hell was that?
I'm definitely really excited about the fans seeing Eleven without powers and her struggle and the frustration of wanting to, you know, use them, you know, because she's so used to using them.
They're nobodies. And you're a superhero.
Not anymore. The fourth season, I really appreciate the Duffers taking away her main ability, her most favorite thing of all, her most valued and dependent thing that she has in her life is her superpowers. And taking that away, where does that leave us? And who am I, really? So it was really great having the first, six episodes to really be able to deep dive into her emotional well-being instead of just her extraterrestrial kind of being, and seeing the real relationship struggles of Mike and Eleven, and putting some strain and some tension on that, instead of it always being like happy daisies, you know?
Are your friends gonna meet us there?
Friends? What friends?
You know, Stacy and Angela.
Angela?
You'll meet them, I promise, just not today. I want today to be about me and you.
I think there's a sense of embarrassment, and humility. She wants to tell him everything's fine, and I think there's a sense of FOMO, you know? She wants to be in Hawkins. She wants to be with her friends, and I feel like she's just trying to let Mike know everything's fine, I'm fine here. I'm actually having way more fun than you are. And really, the bottom line is she's not. She's struggling, and she's hiding that from him. She knows that she has to deal with those bullies and that alone, because no one will truly understand what it's like to be that different. She's not just like a nerd. She's one in a million, you know? She's not really no one like her. And I think that the Duffers made a great decision in splitting us apart. I think showing a different 1980s location, such as California, it's such a different vibe than Indiana in the 80s. Knowing and seeing it on set, it's such a different vibe. It honestly, Finn said it the other day, it does feel like we're filming a completely different show. I think the distance actually creates some development and growth between everyone. But in true Stranger Things style, we always come back together, and it always ends up in the upside down.
H.
Hi.
Hi.
That works! Yes!
Hi.
It's the older teens of Stranger Things who really get the show rolling, because they are the ones with the driver's licenses. With me now are Joe Quinn, joining the cast this year as Eddie Munson, president of Hellfire and Perpetual Hawkins Sr. Maya Hogg, who's left her scooper behind to rewind at the video store as Robin Buckley. And Joe Keery, who plays the lovable slacker slash everyone's favorite babysitter, Steve Harrington. Hi, y'all.
Hey there.
Always the babysitter.
Always the goddamn babysitter.
It is time to talk about friendship in the time of Vecna. Joe and Maya, your characters are both looking for love this season. It's kind of cute but sad. Can you talk a little bit about your fun dynamic as you support each other through this quest?
Oh, that was so fun. I don't know. It was just like...
It's like my favorite part of the
yeah,
season.
Yeah, it's great. It's just a really fun storyline to have kind of always happening underneath all this crazy supernatural stuff.
Yeah.
It feels like it really is like... It roots our storyline in a really nice way.
I think my favorite scene to shoot the whole series was that kind of almost oneer we did in the video store.
Totally, yeah.
Where we're like talking and videos are falling down and like the, and reorganizing things and like that was, I love that stuff. And getting to do that in the beginning before we go on to film the rest of the season, exactly what you were saying, sort of set in like a, I don't know, like what the feeling was on the inside.
And the tone for shooting too.
Yeah.
You know, like the vibe on set was very, very positive and reassuring and easy. And it was like a place to try different things. And yeah, those scenes in a lot of ways, it's like with this show, there's so much supernatural stuff going on. You generally, you know, the setup of the show is where you kind of have more these kind of dialogue driven scenes. And those are generally the ones that are, I find the most fun to work on.
The rapport that you guys have is really genuine, and you just kind of want to see you guys riff on something, like forever.
I know, nice. I remember us joking about when this season started that we were like, can we just have a year, one season where nothing happens?
Yeah, it's just
like,
totally
can we just
normal,
do high school, video store, school. Normal, yeah, like, let me get the girls, like, let's just, and then next season, like, everything can happen, but like, let's just live in,
just
let's
one
live
normal
life for
year.
One season, one normal year.
Joe, your character, Eddie, was an immediate fan favorite. These are not interests that necessarily intersect you personally. You're not a metalhead, you're not a D&D nerd.
Not currently, no.
Not currently?
Not yet.
Is there a possibility that you could be converted to the nerd side?
I'm open to anything.
Wow, okay, you heard it here on Geek.
Really?
That's it.
Do you have any 80s tropes that you drew from?
I guess, well, it's kind of obvious, but Spinal Tap, really. I think kind of just in terms of like how being a metalhead isn't a part-time gig. It's, you've got to take it pretty seriously.
Mm-hmm. Totally.
And I guess kind of like thematically, like in the show, I think there's a lot of John Carpenter stuff in there. I think if, and Scooby-Doo as well in our...
Scooby-Doo.
I think if Spielberg and John Carpenter directed a Scooby-Doo film, it
would be, that would be amazing.
Yeah.
Well, we're in it.
You're totally right. It's like
I think that's what it is.
The strong and different characterizations of each character is very Scooby-Doo and very D&D.
Yeah.
You know, everybody has their sort of specialty and skill and mindset, and they do a good job of making, you know, setting that up.
Definitely.
Brad. From Scooby-Doo.
Who's the blonde? Who's
Fred.
The blonde one?
Fred.
I've
Fred,
definitely
man.
Got a little bit of the.
He's Fred.
You're Fred. You're Fred.
Yeah. Sure.
You're Shaggy.
Maya, what do you think? You're Velma.
Velma for sure. Velma. I mean.
In episode 6, our teens head out on Lover's Lake, where Jock Patrick has just been taken by Vecna. Steve, as former swimming captain, volunteers to head underwater to see if a rift has opened at the bottom of the lake.
There he goes.
This has my favorite moment of yours in it, I think.
So remember you doing all the breath work?
Of course, yeah.
Remember people calling you a rock star?
Yes.
I remember Nimrod saying, yeah! That's not looking good.
Incredible flashlight.
Thank you. My underwater flashlight.
Flashlight.
So Joe, can you talk to us a little bit about filming that scene? Was it in a tank? Like it looked.
Yeah.
It seems like you were underwater a long time.
Yeah, it was like a studio, like probably the size of. It was in a big convention center in Atlanta by the airport, and they built a tank that was probably. How big do you think it was, guys? Like 40 feet. It was a big circle, 40 by. It's probably a few gallons, I think. Yeah, a few gallons. 16 feet down or something. But so they had this scaffolding rig, and then obviously a set at the bottom. And I mean, it was incredible. Yeah, shooting. We all shot on the stage, and it was just getting to do that sort of stuff is like true movie magic sort of stuff, so.
Did you know that you were going to be a swimmer? Because it would be awkward if you didn't know how to swim.
Before the first season, they had told me I was gonna be a swimmer, and in the script they're like, yeah, you're gonna be a swimmer. It's gonna be like some swim meet. Mm-hmm. You're gonna be like in a Speedo. You know, it's the 80s. Yeah. It's like, oh my God, I have to like get in shape, and did all these swimming lessons, and you know, like I was paying for all this stuff, and then I showed up, and they're like, oh no, yeah, we cut that. We couldn't get the gym, we couldn't get the pool. Couldn't get a pool. So that was all cut, and then, but they wrote this back in, you know, later, so it all kind of worked. I could swim beforehand though. Okay. I can't swim.
For the record.
Which is good.
Of course, there's more Stranger Things right around the corner when volume 2 drops on July 1st. Thank you for coming Right Side Up to join me here. I really appreciate this conversation.
Of course.
Thank you.
Sadly, the Star Court Mall was burnt to a crisp in season 3. The upside of no longer having a food court where you can get terrible pretzels? The Hawkins teens are forced to hang out in our studio. Please welcome some familiar faces from our Hawkins crew. Finn Wolfhard, who plays Mike Wheeler, who's about to get his spring break ruined. Gaten Matarazzo, playing everyone's favorite goofy nerd, Dunson Henderson. Priah Ferguson, who plays the ever-resourceful Erica Sinclair. Sadie Sink, who plays a grieving, emotionally closed-off Max Mayfield. And Kayla McLaughlin, playing a too-cool-for-his-normal crew, Lucas Sinclair. So last season ended on a cliffhanger, and season 4 started in chaos right at the bottom. Finn, what was it like to be split up from your crew, your best friend, your girlfriend, Elle? I mean, Mike was separated from Elle before, but it was a little bit different. How was your journey this season?
Yeah, it starts out and Mike's kind of like, I think pretty excited to go and visit his girlfriend, his best friend, but he's kind of a little more disconnected from Will and kind of starting to find his own way as well at high school. He doesn't really feel like separated from people. So he's finally finding his kind of friend group. It's a pretty chaotic season, I would say. It was like so fun and like different. And also pretty amazing too to like start the season off with like Caleb and Sadie and Gaten, because we rarely get to be in scenes together nowadays because there's so many storylines happening. Mm-hmm. And whenever we get to like go back to the kind of the basics and be able to like have like scenes all together that aren't so crazy, and I don't know, it's really, really fun.
Yeah, it was a really fun time jump between seasons, and Max is in a much different place this season, Sadie. Can you talk about why?
Yeah, I mean, she's obviously dealing with the grief and guilt surrounding Billy's death. Her living situation has changed, so things have just kind of gone downhill. Yeah. And that's kind of where we start out with her, and then obviously things get much, much worse.
Yes, we're going to have to get into that, because it's a whole deal. Gaten, Dustin seems to really step up to be more of a leader character this season. How did that feel? Did it feel good?
I think it's cool. I think it's definitely a goal of his to try and feel a little bit more confident going into high school. I think he's kind of put a little bit more emphasis on his look and the group he sees that Lucas is becoming more confident and doing some great stuff and finding himself, and I think in a way that hurts him and motivates him. But yeah, I think it's just a general a confident search, maybe motivated by his friendship with Steve.
But
yeah. It's fun to play. It really is cool to start out that way.
The D&D basketball montage was so epic. I can't believe it, and I would love to show you a clip. Let's take a look.
Let's do it.
Yes.
That's awesome. So cool.
It was the first time we've seen it.
Are you kidding?
No, yeah, first time.
Epic as you thought it was going to be?
Yeah,
more so.
Sick. Yeah.
Go music choice.
Awesome, yeah.
Caleb, how do you relate to Lucas's journey trying to figure out who he is and where he belongs? You are really torn in two different directions this season, right?
Yeah, I understand where Lucas is in his life at the time because he's young, he's a teenager, and kind of go through this, like, time where you're like, okay, who am I? What do I like? Where do I really fit in? You know, the spirit of the world speaks to you. And, you know, I mean, of course, we're probably not gonna, Lucas is not saying that, but I feel like he probably had a moment where it was just like, who am I? Like, let me go figure it out. And, you know, he has his friends there, but he needed to, you know, adventure out to figure out who he was first before he can, like, appreciate his love that he had for his friends and the nerd that he is.
Yeah.
So,
well, it's not unfounded. I mean, no. You are being torn into, and they don't show up for you, so it's a little bit frustrating, right?
I understand why they're upset, because they're like, no, this is how you always been. This is who you are. Like, what are you doing? But, you know, you never realize or you never appreciate things unless you don't have it anymore, you know? Yeah. Until you don't have it anymore. So I felt when Lucas didn't have that friendship or, like, the realness of being with his friends from, you know, the beginning, he was like, okay, I know who I am. He just needed to step out of the box real quick before he realized.
While Lucas is chasing his hoop dreams, Erica takes her seat at the table and joins the D&D campaign. Priya, can you talk about how it felt for Erica to sort of replace her brother this season in the crew?
I definitely feel like it was a leadership moment for Erica. It was her proving to the Hellfire Club that she is a leader and she's a problem solver. And I feel like Erica has always been a leader in the past seasons. Even with the cape, how she came in with the cape, that was a it was her being a leader and stepping in for her brother to help out the Hellfire Club and her friends. So that's how I feel.
Things could not be stranger for Max this season. It is a lot. Sadie, your character has been tormented in the present by the past. We talked a little bit about Max's rough start this season. Why do you think Vecna targeted her of everybody?
Well, I mean, you kind of learn in the season that he targets people that are in a real place. And Max is obviously one of those people, just with everything with Billy. She was kind of like the perfect target, but I think she was a little bit, I guess, stronger than the others through the help of her friends and everything.
Absolutely.
So she had an advantage.
Well, Max trapped in the mine later is the first glimpse that we get into Vecna's ultimate plan. We have a clip. So let's take a look.
More clips.
Wow, that was a lot. Can you talk about filming that escape scene? It was so intense.
Yeah, that was shot over, I don't know how many, I think it might have been a week that we spent on that, or like 4 days, I guess. A lot of time spent in the harness, I guess.
Yeah.
It was pretty intense, and like all the like vines and stuff, like obviously, like none of that's there. We did get really lucky this year because Vecna was pretty much fully practical effects.
Oh, wow.
Which kind of, you know, made it easier for me, so I'm not like staring at a man in a green suit. It was pretty intense. Definitely had some, got a little scraped up, but it was really, really fun.
Can we touch upon the reveal of Vecna 1 Henry? Did that blow your minds like it did the audience?
Yeah, that's like an amazing twist. Jamie's like unbelievable.
Jamie's incredible.
And he had to be, I mean, I only met him a few times, but from what I could hear, I mean, how long was he had to probably, if it was like a 7 a.m. crew call, have to come in at 1 a.m.
What?
The morning before, while they put the makeup on him as Vecna, and he like never complained. He never like.
He's so patient.
I ran into him once throughout the entirety of filming, and it was when we were doing 3D scans.
To touch on Vecna, I thought it was really cool to see the evil of Hawkins kind of reveal itself. Mm. I thought that was really cool, you know.
Finn, Mike doesn't quite get the spring break he hoped for when he imagined in California. How fun was it to film all of the action stuff that you got to do this season?
Really fun and also like incredibly difficult. And we basically filmed a movie within a movie. Like we filmed a different movie kind of and we shot like a stoner thriller comedy kind of, while they shot like a really like a drama filled sci-fi,
like Harold and Kumar on steroids.
Yeah, exactly. And so it was like a really different vibe, and I think like the Duffer Brothers were very excited kind of to have like a different, I don't know, a different change of pace. I think they had also like a new crew and stuff, and so it was insanely fun. I mean, we did this one take action scene. It's like the shootout.
Oh, I saw that. Yeah, amazing.
And so good. That was like a day of rehearsal, and then yeah, it was crazy.
Stay here.
We did it. I mean, we were all like, by the end of it, we were all bruised and like, did you get it? Like all on the ground, like. You know, so it was really fun, but yeah, also, yeah, just like tiring as well.
Well, we actually sat down with director Shawn Levy to talk about shooting that scene. Let's take a look.
Hey there, Felicia, Shawn Levy here. I am super bummed that I can't be with you doing Geeked Week all together, but very much there in spirit. I'm here in Budapest shooting my next project, but completely excited to nerd out alongside Finn and all the rest of the gang who are a part of this epic shootout one-er, which was both the most challenging piece of directing and ultimately one of the most gratifying pieces of directing I've ever done. The writing that Matt and Ross do, it tells me what they want on screen. And so I'm reading episode 4, I come to this shootout sequence and it just felt like, oh, this should feel kinetic and this should feel real time and viscerally connected to the characters who are suddenly caught in the middle of this bedlam.
That was fast.
And I read the scene a few times. I called Matt and Ross and I was like, guys, I'm feeling one-er. Am I crazy or am I feeling one-er? They're like, hell yes. We've never done kind of an action one-er with gunplay. And so it was gonna be hard. It was gonna be near impossible, but I was so inspired by this feeling that I had to try. On a movie, you take months. You literally take months of computer pre-visualizations and storyboarding and rehearsals and re-choreography. It's Stranger Things. We are, at the end of the day, we're a huge TV show, but we're a TV series. So there was no time for previs, no time for storyboards, and we had to essentially choreograph and prep that shootout while we were shooting other scenes every day. So it involved one choreography session where it was myself and my cinematographer and my AD and the stunt coordinator, and we just kind of read the scene in the house. And it was a lot of like, well, what if they come through this window? Well, what if as we're running this way, there's another gunman over here? And it was a lot of what if. And we started acting out the what if.
And then the camera sees you.
What's going on? Look back there?
We gotta go!
And does it.
Crash!
Go, go.
The only way I know how to direct is to kind of viscerally give the actors a sense of the scene. And so for this, I was literally acting out every role of me playing Will Byers and Jonathan and Mike. I do believe that the best way to feed my actors energy is by giving them energy.
What's going on? Get back.
Shit!
We gotta go! We gotta go right now!
The whole challenge with a one-er is it requires perfect synchronicity between actor action, stunt action, and camera action. So every pan, every tilt, every move of the actor, it needs to be in unison so that you're seeing the event you want at the exact moment that you want it. So if one of those three things is a little early or a little late, cut, go again, cut, go again. So it just takes one mistake to make the one-er unusable.
Stay there.
Everybody needed to do their jobs at a high, high level of near perfection, and ultimately, that's a daunting challenge, but an incredibly satisfying piece of filmmaking as a result. This has been a lot of fun breaking down the episode 4 shootout one-er with all of you. Cannot wait for you to see what else we have in store for you in Stranger Things 4. It's a doozy.
And that's our show. I am tempted to end this episode of Unlocked with a crazy twist that would make the Duffer Brothers proud. Or, you know, like a horrible pun. But I'm gonna settle for this. Unlocked will be back after the second and final volume of season 4 drops on July 1st. Oh, and don't go away. We're about to see the Hellfire Club engage in an epic D&D battle right here on Geeked Week. See you then.